If you don't mind, I'm going to stand. And thank you for the organizers of this conference for putting this together and for especially for inviting me. When I was first invited to this conference with the title Liberalism and Challenges, I was, I thought there are lots of different topics I could choose from. There's so many challenges to liberalism, but then as the date approached, I thought that one particular challenge that is on everyone's mind recently is the transnational movement of persons, transnational migration, and the refugee crisis, obviously. I thought that I was going to talk about that. First of all, let me clarify right away what kind of challenge I mean here. There are different types of challenges to liberalism that we might think when we are thinking about the problem of immigration. One is a political challenge, the capacities of liberal democracies to deal with the moral requirements that we think are presented by the problem of transnational migration. That is an important one, and that is what I think occupies most people as they are thinking about this problem today. I'm going to talk about another type of challenge which people might thought there is for liberalism, and this is a challenge of principle. So one might think that principles that are central to liberal political morality pull in different directions when it comes to the problem of immigration. There are some central liberal principles that favor a nearly unconditional right to exclude people from the territory of the state, whereas other principles clearly pull in the direction of a right to enter and settle in the territory of states of those people whose fundamental rights are challenged or violated in their country of citizenship. So in liberal political theory, most people agree that states have a territorial right. That is to say, they have a right to exercise exclusive jurisdiction over their particular territory. And this right is thought to include, or so to involve, the right to exclude, the right to exclude non-citizens. On the other hand, every liberal thinks that persons everywhere in the world have fundamental rights, particularly the right not to be subject to inhuman treatment, the right not to be killed, and so on and so forth, which seems to imply, straightforwardly, that everyone has a right to enter the territory of safe countries if their rights are violated in their own country of citizenship. So it would look like there's a fundamental and direct conflict of principle within liberal political theory. And this is this problem that I'm going to try to explore and say something about in this talk today. And I want to argue that there is no fundamental conflict. In fact, the appearance of the conflict, or the whether or not there is a conflict, depends on how exactly we understand the basis of the territorial rights of states. The territorial rights of states, that is to say, the right to exercise exclusive jurisdiction within their territory. First note about territorial rights. Territorial rights of states do not, as a conceptual matter, include the right to exclude. So it's a substantive claim to say that the territorial right includes the right to exclude non-citizens, which requires further argument. So to establish that states have territorial rights falls short in itself to establish their right to exclude. We need extra argument to say that the right territorial rights involve as their essential part the right to exclude. So what I'm trying to do in this talk is to take a look at different accounts of the basis of territorial rights of states and to see whether and which one of them implies also the right to exclude. And I will argue that the most plausible account of the basis of territorial rights of states do not in fact include the right to exclude non-citizens. So if that is the case, then there is no conflict between the territorial rights of states on the one hand and the rights of individuals anywhere to be safe from inhuman treatment, persecution, and violent death, and so on and so forth. I should start by saying that there are many different accounts of the territorial rights of states, some of which are not relevant from my purposes today because they are not liberal theories or not compatible with liberalism. Some nationalist theories of territorial rights, for instance, associate the territorial rights of states with some idea of national homeland or historical claim, which are not are in significant tension with liberal theory, and I'm interested in only those accounts that are compatible with or consistent with liberal theory, that is to say those that are individualistic in some sense, that rely on individualistic premises. And I identify three different accounts of the territorial rights of state. The first one is a property-based account, which is in intellectual origin, it's a Lockean account. The second account is based in the freedom of association of citizens. It has more recent origins. It's associated most clearly with a contemporary political philosopher, Christopher Wellman. And the third account that I'm looking into is in intellectual heritage. It's a Kantian account, which is associated with the individual's claim to autonomy, basically. And this is how I connect with the panel before lunch. Okay, so the Lockean account of the territorial rights of states suggests that the right of states to exercise exclusive jurisdiction over a particular territory is based on individuals' prior right of property in the land that makes up the territory of the state. So that's a property-based account, which suggests that the territorial right is an aggregation of individuals' right to pieces of the land of the property of the state. Now, I want to deal with this account in a relatively brief manner. You could say I don't do full justice to it. I think the Lockean account of property has well-known problems, internal problems. It's not a theory of property that is widely accepted anymore. And it has special difficulties, external difficulties, as it is applied to the problem of territorial states, when we want to generalize it. First and foremost, because individual claims to property in pieces of the land do not plausibly generalize into a complete control over territory, because there are many pieces of territory within all countries that are not the subjects of individual rights of property in the land. So I don't want to say much more than that about the Lockean theory of territorial rights. There are interesting modern elaborations of it. One is by Karen Nine, which is, I think, the most plausible, but still not very convincing in my view. The second account of territorial rights is the one that is based on the freedom of association of individuals. Suggestion being that individuals have an individual right to associate with whoever they want to, and the right of the freedom of association involves the freedom not to associate with anyone. And the suggestion is that the citizens, the community of citizens collectively exercise this right through their governments, and this straightforwardly implies that they can exclude, they have the right not to associate with any current non-citizens, and for this reason it implies the right to exclude people from, or non-citizens, from the territory of the state. As I said, this is the view that is developed by Christopher Wellman, relying clearly on what is a liberal principle, the principle of freedom of association. I have a number of different things to say against or criticizing this account. The first and most obvious point is that states and the communities of citizens are not voluntary associations. So it is not clear why we should understand the rights of communities as being associational in the same way. Most people do not choose the country of their citizenship. And as a matter of fact, communities of citizens are not voluntary associations. That's one point that I think is fairly fundamental. A related point is that, in addition to the right to exclude, if we were to understand citizenship as a matter of freedom of association, it would have implications that go far beyond the right to exclude current non-citizens. It would have the implication of the right to exclude current citizens as well, because the right not to associate plausibly implies the right not to dissociate from current associates. So it would have the implication, which both in theory and in the practice of liberal democracies is anathema, to the right to deprive of citizenship of current citizens. So someone who endorses the associational view of territorial rights would have to explain why states and communities of citizens lack the right to deprive current citizens of their citizenship. I think that's a tall order. No one can give a plausible account, or it's very hard to give a plausible account or to defend the idea that liberal democracies can exclude current citizens from citizenship. But be that as it may, I want to proceed as though there was a successful defense of this. The next difficulty with the associational theory is that it does not really address the problem of entry and settling in the territory, because it is possible for people to enter the territory of states without becoming citizens. So the associational theory of citizenship is a theory about who might or might not become a member of the community of citizens. It's not a theory about who can enter the territory of states. There's nothing inconsistent or incoherent at first blush by saying that the community of citizens have the right to decide who can become a member of the community of citizens, and at the same time insisting that people who are fleeing war and persecution and torture have the right to enter the territory of citizens of the state. So the link between the freedom of association applied to the problem of the community of citizenship, the community of citizens, is not closely linked to the right to enter into the territory of states. I would venture further by saying that it is not at all clear how living in a shared territory with other people counts as an association in the relevant sense. It is not clear why an association in the sense that is used in the language of freedom of association. We live in a shared territory with people in our neighborhood, in our city, in our countries. It's not clear that we are associated with them in the sense that freedom of association is usually relying on in this context. So I think if we understand living in a shared territory as a form of association, then this account based on freedom of association faces a fundamental and fatal dilemma. If living in a shared territory, or if sharing a territory in the sense of occupying it, counts as association, then it means that the whole of humanity is an association, because we share the territory of the earth. We are commonly occupying the territory of the earth. So if sharing a territory is understood on associational grounds, then it would have the perverse and absurd implication that humanity as a whole has the right to exclude some people from the territory of the earth, which would be clearly absurd and unacceptable, not just for liberals, I guess, but for everyone with a minimum of common sense. I mean, to state the obvious, to live any kind of minimally acceptable life, you need access to territory, to occupy some physical space, and to settle in that territory, some permanent, relatively permanent space. So, if living in a shared territory counts as an association, and freedom of association is understood as Wellman suggests we should understand it, then it would have the absurd implication that humanity can exclude some people from the territory of the earth. Now, what can we do about this implication? One suggestion could be that freedom of association is constrained by access to vital goods. No one can be excluded from the enjoyment of certain vital goods that are necessary for living a minimally acceptable life, with the obvious implication that humanity cannot exclude anyone from the face of the earth. That's fine as far as it goes. But as soon as we accept that concession, we'll see that it will apply not only to humanity as a whole, but also to particular nation states. Because when we are talking about refugees in particular, what they make a claim to is exactly certain vital goods that are necessary to live minimally acceptable lives, and therefore it is the rights of nation states to exclude that is limited by the valid claims to vital goods of refugees. So the concession, though it might seem minor, in fact undermines the associational understanding of the right to exclude from the territory of states. In fact, I think if we make this concession, then we come to realize that the right of association or the freedom of association is a right to associate with the goods that we rightfully have in terms of the appropriate conception of justice. So some conception of justice and what we have rightful claims to is both theoretically prior to and normatively more fundamental than the right of association. And as soon as we understand that, it's clear that the associational story of the right to exclude, or the unconditional right to exclude people from the territory of the state, does not work. Okay, I see that I have only a few minutes remaining, so I'm going to focus on the third account of... Yes. Okay, so I have a little bit more time than I thought. That's good. The third account of the territorial rights of states is a Kantian account, which, broadly speaking, was not Kant's account, but a Kantian account, inspired by Kant, suggests that the territorial grounds of states is grounded in the state's ability to protect individuals' claims based in justice and autonomy. Autonomy, as we've been discussing at various points in the first panel, is the ability to lead your life in accordance with your own values, to take charge of your life, to develop and pursue projects that you think are valuable. And most obviously, the integrity of the structure of our projects requires a right to occupancy, to occupy some permanent space, because most of our relationships, most of our projects are tied to a significant degree to particular spaces, particular places. And for this reason, our autonomy is not safe unless we have some claim to occupy territory, some territory somewhere. Now, that's the first pillar of the Kantian argument. The second pillar is that autonomy can be protected only by a system of laws which makes a state necessary. So the state is necessary for the protection of individual autonomy, and only a state can sustain and implement effectively a system of laws. And the third pillar of the Kantian theory is that the implementation of a system of laws can be effective only if there's a single agent that has exclusive right to implement that system of laws over a particular territory. So that's how we get the territorial right of states. We need a particular political agent, a particular state that can exercise exclusive jurisdiction over a particular territory, operating a system of laws in order to protect the autonomy and just the just claims of individuals. Now, this is the Kantian story, and I'm not going to say more to elaborate it. The question is whether the territorial rights of states understood this way includes the right to exclude or not. And I think it does not. It's not clear why the effective implementation of a system of laws over a particular territory should require control over the composition of the population within that territory. It's not clear why that would be necessary in order for the state to be able to effectively implement a system of laws. And if it is not necessary, then as a conceptual matter and as a substantive matter, the territorial rights of states does not include as an essential component the right to exclude non-citizens. It does not say more than that. But once we recognize that all persons globally have equal rights to autonomy and justice, then it's clear that those persons whose such rights are violated in their own country of citizenship have a right to enter and settle in countries that can protect these interests. A couple of specifications are needed here. I think this right to enter and settle is not held against particular states, such as Germany or other relevant examples. It's held against the community of states. So it's a collective obligation of states that can effectively implement a system of laws to admit to their territory persons whose fundamental rights are violated. So I'm going to say two things. The right to exclude of particular states depends on two conditions. First, this being necessary for the implementation of effective implementation of a system of laws. I think this empirical condition does not obtain most of the time. Most of the time, it is not a necessary condition for states to run, to exercise jurisdiction that they have control over the population. And second, that the community of states or the state system effectively protects the rights of all individuals in autonomy and justice. If that's not the case, then the community of states that in fact can protect the autonomy and just claims of individuals have a duty to admit individuals whose rights are violations. This is a collective obligation of the community of states. The final point is this, and this leads us back to the territorial rights, the proper understanding of the territorial rights of states. Usually, the territorial rights are understood as held by particular states independently on their own. My claim, by way of conclusion, is that if we adopt the Kantian understanding of the territorial rights of states, then it is not in fact held by particular states one by one, independently of each other, but it's held by the international system of states, and it is appropriately distributed to particular states to the extent that it is necessary for them to exercise, to protect the autonomy of individuals. So we should move beyond the understanding of territorial rights and also the rights of refugees as a relationship between particular individuals and particular states to understand both territorial rights as a feature of the international system and the rights of refugees as held against the international system of states and not against particular states. And I think that will help us see that there is no fundamental conflict of principle between the territorial rights of states and the human rights of individuals. Thank you.
Okay, so I'll talk about the parallel tendencies of liberalism and fascism through the perspective of the political economy of Marxism and its analysis of fascism. Now, when the Italian poet and anti-fascist Giuseppe Antonio Borghese wrote in 1934 that not a single prophet during more than a century of prophecies has ever imagined anything like fascism, he had struck a chord that would in time impregnate itself onto the field of European political thought and beyond. There was, in the lab of the future, he says, everything from communism to syndicalism and whatnot. There was anarchism and legitimism, pan-Germanism and pan-Slavism and the yellow peril, and even an all-out papacy. But there was no fascism. It came as a surprise to all and to themselves too. Thus, the youngest political current in Europe, fascism was indeed a violent novelty, as unforeseen as it was influential far beyond its original birthplace. However, after its birth, we must not neglect the fact that not only did it leave a trace onto the existing social, political, and economic relations, but also on the very way in which it was fought after its militaristic defeat. Seldom is a phenomenon alien and foreign to Europe, deprived of its autonomy, culture, or institutional roots, sometimes even robbed in a sort of creationist closing, as if it was created ex nihilo and out of thin air. What characterizes this strand of thought, actually, present even today among liberal thinkers, is the striking lack of conceiving its relation not only to capitalism, but exactly the specific European context out of which it arose. And again, to consider fascism as a sort of European anti-phenomena, as something irrational and alien to Europe and European political traditions, liberalism among them, entails glossing over its very formation, inasmuch as forgetting that these political traditions still today harbor some of the contradictions which have linked their own formation to its emergence as well. Now, considering it as a singularity as well, or as an event somehow transcends historical research, while putting out to the lack of consensus among historians, philosophers, etc., ends up in an equally limiting position in which fascism appears as broken in various forms and stages without much anchor in the political and economic crisis incumbent at the time as much as today. Now, contrary to the above, fascism is not foreign to Europe. As Ishai Lander had put it, rather than alienate from it, we should familiarize ourselves with it. And what's more, we should westernize fascism, so to speak, contrary to its description as a foreign phenomenon. Now, the question then is not if it's familiar to Europe, but how. In that sense, the novelty of fascism is no novelty at all. And if fascism was unforeseen neither by prophets nor by Marxists, it does not follow that it was not present, albeit invisible to the dominant traditions. Here I'll speak a bit more about the liberal split and its relations to fascism. And instead of focusing on the complex issue of the origins of fascism, much less on giving the strict semantic definitions of it, what I will try to do here is to speak about the certain ways in which thinking about fascism today proves to be ever more indispensable for understanding liberalism and the contemporary self-conception of post-war liberalism today as well. In brief, I will argue that the self-conception of neoliberalism is mediated through fascism much more than is usually permitted. And as we shall see, this stems from privatizations to austerity, to the relations between the spheres of politics and economics, to the study of fascism, which tells us very much more than it reveals. And what's more, given the very specific role that the German National Socialism played with regards to post-war European development, it can be said that the revival of post-war liberalism was much more determined by Nazism and the German post-war situation than its 19th century predecessor. In a chapter of The Age of Extreme, the short 20th century, aptly entitled The Fall of Liberalism, Eric Hobsbawm notes that the rapid retreat of liberal political institutions across Europe happened very instantly. The liberal constitutional government, based on democratic elections which were almost universal before the war, have been almost completely gone by 20 years' time, between the March of Rome and the peak of Axis. Britain, Finland, the Irish Free State, Sweden and Switzerland were the only ones who did not disband legislative assemblies and had them consistently during the war, unlike all other European countries who had disbanded them, and even in the case where they rejected fascism altogether. But the main threat to parliamentary democracy did not come from communism, but from the right movement, often anti-revolutionary as well as anti-liberal. And upon distinguishing different types of these right movements of the time, from old-fashioned reactionaries to those aspiring to organic statism and truly fascist movement, Hobsbawm concludes that the only crucial difference between the fascists and the not-fascist right was that fascism existed by mobilizing the masses from below, hence the public theater, the Nuremberg, Piazza Venezia, etc. Although this was no simple reaction to the left, as some would have it, it did end up defeating both the left and the right, and it did so without having to conquer power, in a sense, without any sort of revolution, despite being labeled revolutionary by some, like Mose and others. Both the left and the right were crumbling then, leaving no clear alternative within the liberal parliamentary system. And to return to Hobsbawm, according to him, although fascism was the most clear expression of this liberal institutional retreat, it is a mistake to say that it only appeared in that form as a retreat. It had its autonomy, and other later arguments supported this. But Hobsbawm is also partly right to say that an anti-liberal movement par excellence, such as fascism, wasn't the one who broke them. They would have failed by themselves, said Hobsbawm, through inherent contradictions and not due to external force. He lists several reasons. They could not gain consent upon which they were obliged to rely, and the official liberal theory never recognized the inner workings of the people as a subject, and hence remained blind to classes, which in turn damaged their democratic leaning. And third, according to him, democracies did not govern much. Parliaments were designed to establish limits on those who did so. They were designed to act as brakes, but ended up working as engines. And the night watchman became obsolete, and the 20th century multiplied the occasions on which the governments actually had to govern. Now, while the last and first point may be true, the second is of crucial importance. It's class blindness that is of crucial importance. And in order to proceed, we must question whether this actually is a contradiction for liberalism. Would it fail by itself? I mean, we see contradictions of capitalism each day, and yet it persists as much as fascism did, despite obvious expectations, for example, by the Internationale, that expected him to fall by itself. Now, forgetting the classes in parliamentary democracy can only appear to us as a contradiction. If we still remain stuck to the ancient conception of democracy before the 20th century, before the USA Constitution, etc., as a tool for social classes, which is precisely how not to conceive democracy now in parliamentary democracy, as Ellen Maxens would point it out. For the Greeks, it might appear as a contradiction, but not to a 20th century member of parliament, of course. Now, viewed from the outside, rather than merely not observing the class differences of people, liberal democracies actually contributed to them. And to this extent, Hobsbawm's thesis of the crumbling of parliamentary democracy and the rise of fascism has to be supplemented with something else. And we turn now to Ishailanda, who says, I quote, "An indispensable historical precondition for fascism was the inherent tension between the political dimension of the liberal order and its economic one." Landa advances an erudite study of the history, the split from Fox to Burke to Spiro to Hayek, Mises, and even Milton and so on, and the Nazi parallels, showing a line that can be traced all the way up to the crumbling of the institutions that Hobsbawm indicated. And liberalism itself was not to blame for fascism, and we need to point this out, as Landa does, but by dividing and bifurcating itself onto political and economic liberalism, which Landa calls the ideological expression of capitalism, it preconditioned fascism through excluding politics from the economy. So the gist of the question is now, what is the relations of both movements to capitalism? Now, as Landa noted, we should familiarize ourselves with fascism and not analyze it as an alien phenomenon to European history. We need to westernize fascism, meaning to uncover its relations to capitalism and even European liberalism. But what Landa does not do is tell us how to do this. Landa does not tell us how to westernize fascism, but instead he only draws analogies between the two, as most authors often do. For example, we just need to remember the initial analytical weapon that Marxism had. And the International was the Marxist 18th premier, Louis Bonaparte, later to become known and often quoted in Bonapartist theories, drawing analogies between the two. But we need much more than that. It is not enough to draw similarities. and hence we do not intend to focus on particular authors or prove that for every economic liberal that exists is Nazi equivalent, as Land often likes to do. But what we do need, instead of a positivist comparison, especially in light of the current set of crises, is a more structural analysis of the ways in which they interrelate. And I will argue that it is here that we need to revisit Marxist currents, which hold considerable conceptual advantages and which are indispensable for thinking relations between fascism and liberalism is more than that of analogy. As I have mentioned, the reason for this is that what needs explaining is exactly the mutual relation to capitalism, which we would actually lose an important link in the chain without. So, this is what connects them together. And all those who think that simply reiterating Horkheimer's advice, on the other hand, on the relation of fascism and capitalism is enough, would not find it easy to consume the rather contradictory and difficult path that contemporary Marxism went through in the last century. As Martin Dollard put it, the problem of the analysis of fascism isn't simply that it's a special field for Marxism, and that every major Marxist in the 20th century wrote in fascism, but the fact that even areas which do not concern fascism hold crucial importance, as the assumption of its reflection must lie implicit in them. And the importance of this is, of course, the defeat of the workers' movement, which no triumphalism would be able to overcome. And according to Dollard, the analysis of fascism in a full sense is a self-reflection of Marxism. Thus, the novelty of fascism and its surprising historical rise put the theory that through Engels become known as historical materialism to the test. It's not surprising that even here we find very different confrontation and a very agonistic order of theoretical approaches rather than hegemonical, rather than seeking some hegemony, some homogeny of Marxist approach. And sometimes these theories were, of course, full of reductionism, either to Bonapartism or the economy as in the Third International, or to psychology as in Reich, and sometimes it was even presented as a phenomenon devoid of ideology, as some currents of the Frankfurt School did. And not to mention the reduction of fascism to microfascism, which still leads to its conceptual inflation on the contemporary left. And finally, we reach the point where, to remedy this, we need to outline the relation of fascism to capitalism, which I will do here on the specific case of German National Socialism, and not only for the sake of brevity, but because the fact that Germany, and not today or Japan, led fascism to the world stage, as Hobsbawm indicated, both politically and economically, giving it distinct features from other fascist countries. Now, I will sketch some important questions which stem from the political economy of fascism. One of them, the first one, actually concerns its very existence. It has been said that Marx has lost the object of his analysis here, and the new order of fascism transcends its analysis. And as such an example, I will take Pollock, the last, so to speak, canon member of the Frankfurt School, as he can be called, and the economist behind Horkheimer and Adorno's conception of mass society, who engaged in a debate with Franz Neumann over the primacy of the political or economical in nationalist socialism. So his description of the new order is very particular. National Socialist Germany represents a new order with regards to our parliamentary democracy and its institutions, as was capitalism to feudalism. But what's more, his conception of National Socialism is that of a perfect economy. It has removed unemployment, the market, and the shifts between supply and demand, the trade cycle, and any other previously known route of the crisis. It was not an end of capitalism, but of its liberal phase, a command economy contrary to the exchange economy with the primacy of the state and political, which he terms state capitalism, a conception that would later significantly influence other members of the school and beyond. Now, he says, I quote, "In analyzing the structure of state capitalism, I am unable to discover such inherent economic forces that would prevent the functioning of the new order. The causes of depression, of cumulative destructive processes, and the unemployment of capital and labor are gone. The economic problems in the old sense no longer exist. when the coordination of all economic activities is effected consciously instead of by natural laws, quote, of the market. And another one, he says, is that as far as the purely economic aspect is concerned, I cannot see serious dangers to the continuance of the new order if Germany should succeed in acquiring adequate control of supply of raw materials and foodstuffs, etc. So, according to him, one can fail only by intervening through politics into the economy, because then one attacks the economy from outside, so to speak. But this is impossible there where economic laws have been put out of operation by depriving the market of its functions, like in National Socialist Germany. And according to him as well, there was nothing economic in its economy, and hence it was a perfect economy with nothing left to case, especially not the market relation. Prices have been frozen, and although fluctuations were some still permitted, they no longer serve as signals for increasing or curtailing production. Now, I'll sketch three of his points here in order to later refute them. First is the one concerning the ruling classes, the big business, army, party, and bureaucracy. According to Pollock, they now share the coercive power previously held by monopoly of the state that stood above them all. Previously, power was derived from one's property, whilst now it is determined by its social function. And instead of market and property rights, the status of the individual in the group decides the use of his property. And he sees this interestingly as part of the universal trend of divorcing ownership and control. Now, small capitalists in this sense could easily be eliminated, according to him, by refusing production raw materials or labor hiring, while the big ones could be reduced to mere rentiers. This is the first point. Now, the second one. He says that although the legal institution of individual property has been preserved and the claim of capital return with it as well, the owner's right to control is subject to manifold restrictions by supranational organizations, industrial and financial combines like the National Economic Chamber and so on. But the function of private property has changed, and it's subject to a general program of the government. In essence, you can profit if it suits us, if it suits the state. Now, from this stems the so-called synthesis between the government and the private enterprise, with its corollary, the disappearance of the rule of law as equally binding for ruler and ruled. Then he adds, there will and there were and there are profits in Nazi Germany, but the profit system, as we have known it, is nevertheless dead. Profits have lost their major economic function, namely to direct the flow of capital. And to put it paradoxically again, under National Socialism, the production is for use and not for profit. This is the second point. The third one, the integration of society. So, according to him, National Socialism abolished the last vestiges of free economic subjects. Property and income do not determine the social position of the individual anymore. Capitalists and labor are organized alike in the so-called labor front. Wages are paid, but they have lost their function of distributing labor power in the economic process. Money gives only limited power to no power at all in the case of the Jews. And political power, which equals now the control of the means of production, may become the source of unlimited power, says Pollock. So the leaders and followers' relation is subjected to bureaucratic control as well. Now, to recap just. The first point was that the ruling classes share the coercive power by expanding not by property but by political control their own power. Second, subjecting profits and enterprises to the state in a compulsory union. And third, the cross-class integration into corporate syndicates, which reduce the role of wages and labor power and even determine who can be a homo economicus at all. Now, I will reply to this point by point shortly. The first point actually concerns the role of private property as well as the ruling classes. And with regards to the private property, the political control of the economy was contrary by no means unlimited. It is rather extravagant to say that it was unlimited in National Socialism, and the state policy of rationalization and autarky and non-dependence on inputs belonged to National Socialist policies, but they still left much room for private initiative. Despite the so-called new plan of 1934 of state priorities, most of the investment initiatives still came from private enterprises and not from state itself. As Christoph Buchheim and Jonas Schöne argue in their text on the role of private property in National Socialism, the crux of the new plan was that it should be carried out by private enterprises and not nationalized or in public property. Also, the new compulsory capitalization law from 1933 was in part intended to stop spreading new industrial capacities where there was no need, but also to protect the small and middle range enterprises from market pressure and to control investment. But the role of private property was not limited only to private investment initiative. The state even actually began to sell its shares and started a new process with a view on actually increasing the private sector. And this process had a name. It was reprivatisierung, reprivatization. So in National Socialism you had a start to the processes of privatization. For example, in the year 1936 and 1937, the capital of the Deutsche Bank, Commerzialbank and Dresdner Bank was sold to private shareholders, and the state withdrew from the boards of these banks. It was the same year that the Reich sold the shares of the Vereinte Stahlwerke. And not only that, but the state even had different packages on offer to private, mostly industrial enterprises, pointing to some parallel form of leasing, which these authors suggest, and the possibilities to buy an industry after it obtained control over them, and so on. So, there was different sorts of how private property was managed by the state and handed over to private owners. But what's most important here is the point of entry of the history of reprivatizations. Max Heinz Swiezy, the wife of Paul Swiezy, was one of the first to write on the topic. And according to her, this policy, and this should sound very familiar to us, was one of the crucial points for the NSDAP's ascension to power. I quote, "In return for business assistance, the Nazis hastened to give evidence of their goodwill by restoring to private capitalism a number of monopolies that have been held or controlled by the state. This policy implied a large-scale program by which the government had transferred ownership to private hands. And one of the main objectives of this policy was to stimulate the propensities to save, since the war economy required low levels of private consumption, it was thought. High levels of saving were thought to depend on inequality of income, which would be increased by inequality of wealth. And this, according to Swiezy, was thus secured by the reprivatization. The practical significance of the transfer of government enterprises into private hands was thus that the capitalist class continued to serve as a vessel for the accumulation of income." Which actually sounds pretty familiar to the arguments you hear now about privatization. And now, this leads us to the second half, concerning the ruling classes. First, against the usual notion of National Socialism being an agent of monopoly capital or the last card of the bourgeoisie, as it was often quoted in the International, two things must be stressed. On the one side, NSDAP did not receive financial backing of the bourgeoisie all the way up to 1932, when the National Right Party was still supported, and that is up to until Hitler's chancellery. On the other side, the bigger industrial cartels themselves were far away from being a homogeneous group. Alfred von Rethel, a socialist and anti-fascist himself working at the Mitteleuropäer Wirtschaftsrat, an institute, a big institute of business and a hub of German financial capital, who would later also become a close member of the Frankfurt School as well, is often credited amongst those for distinguishing the two camps of industrial cartels in his economy and class structure of German fascism. For example, he writes that there existed the different fractions of the monopoly capital, the so-called Brüning camp, Siemens, IG Farben, the chemical trust, and so on, and the other, the Habsburg front, Schacht, Thyssen, Flick, and the main financiers of the Steel Trust, the Coal Syndicate, and Borsig, the locomotive company, and so on. The usual story goes that the first one was more export-oriented, while the other one supported Hitler and was more autarky-oriented and pro-dictatorship and against the labor movement. But Rattle stresses that these export versus autarky labels are wrong, and that the differences were in method rather than in the general policy by which they sought international competition abroad. Both were subject to Germany's weak economic position within the global market during the Depression as a debtor country with no access to foreign capital influx. And on the other hand, the losing heavy industries were more prone for a need for increased exports and productivity, and hence were keener to support the rearmament and the autarky program, which does not exclude opting for export, and quite the contrary. But the important thing is that their regrouping and consequential support for Hitler represented what is often blamed as the economic condition for the advent of the National Socialism. From here on, one can deduce its expansionary policies with a crippled world market and so on. But what you need to assert here is to remember Lanzas, who, writing against the economic reductionism of the international, stressed that the coupling of the political crisis with the economic one was crucial for the advent of National Socialism. I will briefly outline what is at stake here. According to him, big capital can be well established in the economic zone, but the political shift is that what counts. The crisis of party representations, which, like I mentioned in the beginning, leads to the emergence of a hidden parallel networks in which formal power is distinguished from real power in the incumbent power block. This is a situation in which no ruling class can establish hegemony outside, inside the present institutional framework, thus causing a crisis of hegemony and ideology all pertinent to Plantz's analysis. Thus, a specific state of exceptions emerges, different from purely military dictatorship or Bonapartism. And I say this to stress that the interrelation between these factors, the contradictions inside the cartels themselves, and the political crisis within the power bloc, whose interplay has opened up space for the ideological complex ends up with its initial anti-capitalism and so on, was the key. So, of course, this is a sort of sketchy and simplified description, but one that sufficiently counters Pollock and his thesis of a state-controlled economy as it presupposes political and economic homogeneity at the time. That would be impossible. So, this would also be important for our last thesis on fascism and the following reflections as well. And the second and third point, the union of the state and enterprise and wages and cross-class approach, are two points that can be treated together, so I will, for the sake of brevity, treat them as such. Now, in the German context, there was, to shorten a bit, there was the Iron Front, which comprised social democrats and unions, etc., wanted to participate in the government to induce some form of workers' participation, but ended up actually being destroyed by the government itself and pacifized. Now, this move came in May 1st, 1923, when the National Socialist Party held May Day celebrations, upon which they immediately seized the houses of unions and workers' banks and the presses in the entire territory of Germany, and instead establish a very particular institution called the Arbeitsfront, the Workers' Front, which actually gave control of the seized property. And the Arbeitsfront, in a sense, represented a crucial point for the Nazi economy when it began to take its full shape. The Arbeitsfront represented the symbiosis of capital and labor, of course, at the expense of labor. Workers were fixed to their workplace, could no longer sign collective agreements, and were subject to compulsory membership in an organization that, by its own definition, combated capitalism, liberalism, but also revolutionary tendencies. Now, I will quote here Zoran Vitaković, less known but an important Yugoslav theorist, who pointed out that the key thing here is that Nazi economy abolished what is the so-called bourgeois freedom of wage labor. In essence, the freedom of the worker as an owner of his labor power to sell this labor power in a contractual relations to the capitalist. And of course, as Heinrich pointed out, the fact that labor and capital could enter into an equal relation without appearing contradictory was a historical novelty that could only be resolved by a contractual nature of that relation. And it is here that this relation was stripped of its contractual stripes and left labor devoid of any influence over the process of work. Thus, the political and economic power of the worker were actually separated. They were the one subjective point of the presupposition of class struggle, and they were now, in a sense, deleted. Now, Vidaković adds that an ideal and laboratory clean form of capitalism and the abstraction to which it always gravitates would comprise the capitalist class using labor power, but without entering into market relations as such with their owners of labor power. And this tendency was always present and influenced various historical struggles, but in National Socialism it found its full expression, its double negation of a freedom to enter contractual relations and a freedom to resist. Now, finally, this actually has to do with something other than the purely economic factor, and that is the violence imposed by the National Socialist economy. This I will actually add one other thesis by Ramon et al., often forgotten, and that is the shift of class struggle. Now, destroying the workers' resistance and seizing the workers' ability to enter contractual relations, one actually prevents the class struggle from being played out between the workers and the bourgeoisie, and hence shifts it between the bourgeoisie itself, from which stems the rest of the economic contradictions of National Socialism. And the other consequence of this, which I will briefly mention, but it's very important for the economy, actually, of National Socialism, is its violent implementations in racism, to which some authors were stressful employment with fascism, Pollock amongst them, often failed to see what actually took place. Now, what is how much time I have?
Well, okay, depends what sort of measure we apply.
You can tell me if it's...
Well, in fact, if you would like go to the conclusion,
okay.
I think that would help us out.
Okay, so I'll shorten this bit. Well, basically, the racism, unlike what Landa and Christo Buchheim and Jaschere and other authors imply, it was not actually just simply a political expression or whatever, devoid of the relations of production and the like. It was actually part of the division of labor. So the people of the lower races, to speak of other degraded parts of citizenry, means actually to speak of the division of labor between inside the National Socialism, in which they did play a role. And economic reasoning here implies that it should not be excluded as extra economic stances, which Landa quotes as a crucial difference in analyzing fascism. Now, he says that to it, in strictly economic terms, the Nazis were commonplace, but this sort of an analysis of economy of fascism does not and need not include an extra economic factors in it. So, okay, I'm skipping some parts, but okay.
Do you mind jumping to your conclusion or your concluding remarks?
I have 5 more minutes.
Well, if you have 5 more minutes,
okay, I'll skip
double time. Now we risk losing you. That's all.
Yeah. Okay. We can go into this discussion at some point. So basically, instead of proving this strict economical analysis as something that does not exclude racism and other things, we need to actually broaden it and to incorporate these factors as well. And only then will the relation between fascism and liberalism become known to us as a tendency which actually stems out from the crisis of civil society, as was advanced by Rainer Kuhlner and other authors. And regarding neoliberalism, and to jump to these post-war years, I'll just briefly mention the thesis made by Varoufakis, who denotes that after the war, the most destroyed economies, National Socialism, in Germany and the Japan economy were actually the most ones that were resurrected by the Marshall Plan as export-oriented industries imported for their region. And what's more, this sort of development, when on the one side you have the Marshall Plan development of liberalism, the social market Wirtschaft, and on the other hand, you have this need to confront national socialism, is something that has been crucial for the European project as well. Now, apart from this historical development, I think that this tendential similarity between liberalism and fascism can be epitomized in one sentence by Gaspar Mikl Stamos, who wrote that contemporary post-fascism, sans one-party rule, sans SA or SS, reverses the Enlightenment tendency to assimilate citizenship to the human conditions. So it does not exist by mobilizing the masses from below, but exactly by the opposite, by demobilizing them from above. And if it were not by its name, neoliberalism could designate a similar process which is taking place. For example, by atomizing the contractual relations between capital and labor, precarious work, the neoliberal variant of flexible work hours amounts to a regime of flexible accumulation akin to prohibition of collective agreements and slashing labor rights that has happened in its predecessor and National Socialist Germany, especially akin to the labor law reforms that has swept the bottom countries as well. And by implementing some of the same strategies, including privatization, which became the emblem of post-war neoliberalism, if it did exactly the same that these strategies were intended to do, they did now, to give power to the appropriated classes and to endorse austerity to those who are not. And I finish now.
Well, thank you very much for your patience. The genealogy of liberalism is inseparable from the social history of secret. Thousands of liberals made war against the mysteries of the pre-modern state, but on the other hand, many of them engaged in the intellectual and political struggles against the arcana imperii of the absolute state as well, in the name of transparency and accountability. Even though liberals themselves often participated in esoteric communicational forms of secret societies, they mostly consider these alternative communities as merely transitional ways that lead to a transparent system. Those who treated liberalism as a version of emancipatory enlightenment, Aufklärung, and not as an ideology of a bureaucratic absolutist state, aimed for a post-secret politics. For them, the manipulative logic of secrecy belonged to pre-liberal dark times. That is to say, there was a liberal dream of a society in which there are neither state secrets nor secret anti-state activities. Even critical realists like Montesquieu claim that, I'm quoting the Considerations on the Greatness and Decline of the Romans, since the invention of postal service, conspiracies in the state have become more difficult because the public has all private secrets in its power. Now that everything is brought to light, with more facility and dispatch, conspirators are discovered no matter how little time they lose in making their arrangements. Surely, the Aufklärer relation to secrecy sometimes tended to be extremely radical. The radical revolutionaries of France, from the Jacobins to the Enragés, forbade every form of closed political organization, clubs, groupuscules, and in fact parties as such. They all concluded that closed non-public politics is a contradiction in terms. When their red heirs came to power during the October Revolution, one of their first gestures was to make public the secret documents and hidden international treaties of the Tsarist regime. Lenin and Trotsky were in a certain way the forefathers of WikiLeaks. From this point of view, the liberal approach tended to be much more moderate. The purpose of this paper is to sketch the most challenging dilemmas concerning the relation between liberalism and secrecy. My impression is that the problem of secrecy and intelligent agency still belongs to the grey areas of mainstream liberal political philosophy. However, the fastly growing field of intelligence studies incorporates many aspects of liberal political thought. I will try to thematize the most important questions regarding
the way that liberal democracies are constituted, the separation of powers, public reason, the rule of law, and the private sphere. Before I go into details, I would like to make some remarks. Firstly, we should avoid to treat secret and transparency as a binary opposition. The call for absolute transparency in the private life of citizens or the desire to create absolutely secret state mechanisms can both be desires of a tyrannical, absolutist or totalitarian state. Absolute transparency and absolute secrecy are both threats to democracy. And as far as contemporary liberal democracies are concerned, it is more productive to regard secrecy as transparency's complement. In other words, it might be true that the transparent social spheres can be maintained only by secret mechanisms. There might be a paradoxical task of operating in secret in order to defend an open society. And it is a constitutive fact that secrecy is caught up in a profound paradox of being both a consolidation of and a threat to democracy. Transparency and openness are the traditional liberal antidotes to excessive secrecy, but not to secrecy as such. So I completely agree with Claire Birchall when she claims that we need to find different ways of staying with the aporia of transparency as secrecy and secrecy as transparency. The same caution is desirable in the case of other dyads, public and private security and liberty, secrecy and revelation. Secondly, the conceptual role of secrecy in liberal democracies differs radically from the arcana imperii of the absolutist state. While the latter mean political governmental techniques that do not require further explanation and legitimation, the establishment of popular sovereignty and democracy started with the purging of the arcana from politics and, as Reinhard Koselleck puts it, an entirely new culture of secrecy was created. The bourgeois criticism of absolutist sovereignty involved more than the mere demand that politics should be open to participation and publicity. Every kind of secrecy in public matters became extremely suspicious. Let me quote Eva Horn here. Political secrecy arouses both profound suspicion and intense curiosity, and this is precisely what makes the logic of secretum, rather than that of the arcanum, the specifically modern logic of the secret. While arcanum is the secret locked away and silenced, the secret as secretum is more an effect than a muted form of real information, a form of social relation, unlike pre-modern regimes that viewed their arcana imperii as a legitimate part of governance. Modern governments tend to make a secret of their dependence on secrets, most famously in the plausible deniability that for a long time was used by the US government to dissociate itself from the activities of its own intelligence services. End of quotation. To put it briefly, paradoxically, in liberal democracies, secrecy tends to be secret. There is a seemingly necessary self-concealing of secrecy. So these are the reasons because of which the citizens in liberal democracies instinctively treat governmental secrecy with a profound distrust, and it is a constant source of speculation, dramatization, and fictionalization. Secrecy is constantly in need of legitimization, yet never really legitimate enough. However, curiously, even though this mistrust is an essential part of modern societies, the catchword of democratic intelligence oversight is a recent phenomenon that appeared only in the mid-1970s. As a result, the last two decades were marked by an outbreak of a prescriptive turn in intelligence studies with substantial ethical analysis beyond mere procedural evaluation and even with the request for extraordinary or specialized morality. The debates are driven by the necessity of constant moral and political legitimization. How is a state or a governmental secret constituted? How is secrecy as the obscure, irregular, latent, or opaque side of power constituted? What does it mean when something essential is revealed only in camera, non-publicly, in chambers? What does it mean, for instance, when a region like Greenland or Åland gains autonomy, except from the autonomy with regard to mainland intelligence agencies? What does it mean when European citizens refuse to support a common European intelligence agency? One should take Edmund Burke's remarks seriously. There is a sacred veil to be drawn of all governments. As if there were already a founding inequality which renders state or governmental secrecy operative. Intelligence agency as a prolongation and institutionalization of martial knowledge always already identifies state enemies not only through counter-terrorism or counter-espionage, but also by countering threats that are supposed to be dangerous with regard to the democratic nature of the state, as it is the case of counter-radicalization policies. Thus, the conditions of democracy have to be defended with pre-democratic or non-democratic means, and there is necessarily pre-political enmity. Intelligence is a sort of knowledge that is haunted by the phantasm of the enemy. Secrecy structures social or political relations of exclusion and inclusion by separating those who are acceptable and those who are not, and on the other hand, separating those who know from those who do not, but who may know at one point or who doubt or suppose that there is a secret. It constitutes their relation. There is secrecy as social capital, there is lack of the access to secrecy as a disadvantage, and finally, there is secrecy that automatically excludes or punishes undesirable practices. Secrecy assures the existence of the political community, and at the same time, it makes it impossible. Thus, secrecy is not merely a functional souterrain of politics as a stabilizing basis removed from sight, but a founding principle. It seems that within this framework, the citizen's consent is necessarily hypothetical and simulated. The expressed consent of the citizens is absent, it is sacrificed in advance. Is a contractualist legitimization of intelligence agencies and substantially opaque authorities possible? And is an original contract concerning state secret possible at all? Alain de Verbe summarizes his own position in a categorical way. A social contract abolishes any possibility of secrecy in the execution of power, any lack of transparency in the intentions of the sovereign, any excess in carrying out government business, and any legal threshold region that would allow for the employment of clandestine means. All power will be dominated by the principle of publicity. Liberal thought censures the space of the secret. However, I would like to suggest that liberals try to elaborate much more subtle solutions. There is enormous fear of a state within the state as a zone sanitaire for democratic scrutiny, a no-go zone for ordinary citizens with a life of its own, a special power accountable only to itself, wielded under the shroud of non-communication, non-documentation, non-reporting, and so on, with a constant abuse of power, such as extra-legal surveillance missions, body and house searches, the monitoring of conversations, and the use of special interrogation techniques. Of course, the classical liberal democratic answer to this fear is in keeping with the balance of powers doctrine. But my impression is that this position struggles with many difficulties and paradoxes. A quotation from Hans Born and Thorsten Wetzling might illustrate one of these well. Interestingly, the danger of politicization of the intelligence services can be regarded as a downside of the increasing democratization of intelligence oversight. On the one hand, introduction of more transparency and public accountability leads to a better system of checks and balances on the services. On the other hand, the services and their activities are becoming part of the normal political debate, which leads to the danger that the actors in that political debate will use the services and their work for their own benefit. So, in other words, there is a built-in fear of democratization. It seems that the pre-political or parapolitical character of intelligence services must be defended. Within the liberal framework, intelligence is conceived as something that can be and has to be depoliticized. It must be free of political spin. An analyst is expected to assess the facts in a dispassionate manner, and so on. However, the very same concerns may lead to diametrically opposed conclusions. Parliamentarians may be prevented from pursuing intelligence oversight precisely in order to prevent the politicization of intelligence, but the same fear led some states to restrict the executive's influence on intelligence and increase bipartisan parliamentary oversight. Once again, in order to prevent the politicization of intelligence. Moreover, while many theoreticians claim that political parties may take advantage of intelligence oversight, other theoreticians suggest that there is insufficient motivation of parliamentarians to engage in proactive oversight, given the fact that there is no direct reward from voters for closed committee sanctuaries. If there is an input relation and direction, that is to say, an ex ante relation between the executive and intelligence services, there is a danger that state secrecy will be governed by arbitrary political preferences, much beyond political neutrality. On the other hand, if there is an output relation and control, that is to say, an ex post relation between parliamentarians and intelligence services, there is a danger that ex post facto accountability will be merely reduced to a modest firefighting. In fact, there is always a meta-dilemma of depoliticization and political decisions. Intelligence agencies must not be political. No intelligence agency shall exert influence over the political situation of a country and the existence of legally formed political parties. However, there are necessarily matters of political sensitivity, and the executive has to be included into decision-making. Thus, intelligence agencies are constantly vacillating between self-depoliticization and excessive open-door politicization. As expected, the standard liberal answer deals with the combination of these aspects in order to assure checks and balances, and it tries to create pluralistic, flexible accountability mechanisms within today's disaggregated sovereignty and networked governance, including internal intelligence control by the services, judicial review, and external review by independent civil society organizations. Very similar difficulties appear in the case of these other branches of power. For instance, it is claimed that the too intrusive control by the judges carries them into the executive sphere, that is to say, it blurs the separation of powers between the two branches of the state. So, to put it simply, who guards the guardians? This accountability gap may be formulated even more radically. I am quoting Eva Horn once again. The logic of Arcanum keeps compromising information locked away not only from public scrutiny, but from government scrutiny as well. no form of parliamentary control as it has been established since the 1970s in the United States, and Europe can overcome this essential dilemma. Control is possible only to the extent that the controlled institution cooperates, not only by operating by the book, but also by documenting and reporting each and every one of its misdemeanors. From former director of Central Intelligence, William J. Casey's famous dictum, "The business of Congress has to stay out of my business," to George Tenet's stonewalling vis-a-vis the Joint Committee in 2002, this hasn't always been the case. And control is possible only to the extent that the controlling organ really wants to know. Congress is informed to the degree that Congress wants to be informed, as former DCI William E. Corby put it. End of quotation. And there are really many important case studies, for example, the analysis of Poland's intelligence oversight practices that revealed that the parliamentarians' access to classified information remains very much dependent on the discretion of the services. During the remaining time, I will very briefly, okay, I will do something very briefly, but not that briefly. I will very briefly sketch some challenges to the liberal democratic interpretation of public reason, the rule of law, and the private sphere, really, really briefly. It seems to me that an expression introduced by Jacques Derrida might be extremely useful: secrecy effect, effet de secret. Here, the secret is not so much a given, yet hidden piece of information. It is not a piece of withheld knowledge, as a secrecy effect that structures social and political relations between those who are supposed to know and those who suspect, who are excluded from this knowledge. This effect is the awareness or belief or suspicion that a secret exists, which, especially in the context of power relations, can have a greater impact than a real secret. Everything depends on the supposition that there is a secret, not its actual existence or its content. Or, as Haverkamp puts it, there is something manifest that nonetheless is not open to negotiation. So even though, owing to the so-called open source revolution, overwhelming percentage, sometimes upwards of 95% of the information mix provided to decision makers in the form of intelligence reports is based on open sources and the mechanisms of democratic intelligence policies are expanding, there is still secrecy, and the secrecy effect that ruins confidence between citizens. The existence of secret agencies in an open society presents a dilemma for liberal democracies, as if there could always be, how should I put it, infrapolitical, metapolitical, parapolitical backgrounds of politics that necessarily undermine the logic of free public debate, of public reason. That is to say, because of the secrecy effect, the mere possibility of intervention by state services, non-public decisions made by politicians, supra-etatic and international secret treaties function as a form of looming latency or potentiality that is more powerful than their actual content. How is the truly informed consent of citizens possible in a system in which a president might claim, just as Bill Clinton did, "Every morning I start my day with an intelligence report"? It is not necessarily the actual content of secrecy, but the secrecy effect that makes it that governmental and state statesmen might be treated as one-sided manifestations of a duplex veritas. From this point of view, the illusion of a public sphere with free flow of information disappears. The secrecy effects open up a space of speculation, conflicting versions, distrust, and paranoia. And what makes it all this even more complex is the possibility that intelligence agencies do not only hide something from the public, but they might at the same time form public opinion through public diplomacy, astroturfing and psi operations with infiltration of political parties, trade unions or civil society groups and so on. Now, few remarks on the rule of law. And then on privacy very briefly, and then I really finish. Of course, there are many theoretical experiments that apply Schmittian or Agambenian concepts of the state of exception, which can be really useful. And for instance, Schmitt has inspiring analysis on modern arcana, on secrecy as a discretionary space of action exempt from the rule of law, but which ignores the law so as to allow it to become effective. In many liberal democracies, there are non-public laws and codes concerning the functioning of intelligence services. There are situations when it is claimed that intelligence services are OBE, that is to say, they are overtaken by events, and there is necessary flexibility in times of crisis, as defined by the White House, for instance. There can be situations when it is precisely secrecy that enables the law to operate, or that is used to re-establish the rule of law in times of turmoil and crisis. So this way, secrecy is the precondition for the functioning of the law. And surely there can be many extra constitutional activities by intelligence services. Or, on an international level, for instance, the American CIA or the French DGSE is granted by the national executives to break non-American or non-French law if this is deemed necessary for the pursuit of its operations. One might say that the true challenge is not when secrecy is considered to be part of the classic state of exception as a temporary suspension of the entire legal order, but when it is treated as a permanent possibility inherent in the state itself. So this is not a state of exception, but exception within the state or exception between states. And one might even go further by claiming that intelligence agencies as institutions of this permanent possibility of the suspension of the law even contain the possibility of suspending suspension through a well-embedded whistleblower protection. To sum it up, this critical strategy suggests that there is a hollowed-out state taken over by exceptional sovereign powers which drive on legal black holes and the suspension of the law. However, I accept the critical remarks of Mark Nieuwkloos against this critical strategy. As Nieuwkloos points out, this critique does not take into account the fact that the state's executive branch has been the main architect of repressive security measures. At the same time, Nieuwkloos rejects the false distinction between the realm of law and the realm of politics on which liberals concerned with the rule of law rely. The liberal assumption that the law is the ultimate protector of democracy does not allow a questioning of the rule of law, the ways in which it facilitates the elimination of basic rights and freedoms in the name of security. In other words, secrecy must not be analyzed only one-sidedly as a social sphere in which there is a constant possibility of the suspension of the rule of law, but also as a social sphere which serves the rule of law. And finally, the question of privacy and the private sphere. I really don't want to go into details. I would just like to quote the book written by Lawrence Creel, Secrets and Democracy from Arcana Imperii to WikiLeaks. He claims that he takes secrecy, I quote, as a penumbra of definitions that relate to a particular form of privacy, one that was rigorously defended in English common law and by the theorists in the liberal tradition drew a defense of privacy from the right to own and defend private property, end of quotation. My impression is that liberal theorists, according to their standard intuitions, overemphasize the questions of legitimate or illegitimate state coercion, and they mostly ignore the metastructure, the reflection of the dyadic structure, public-private. On the one hand, liberal approaches to secrecy mostly ignore the question of industrial, economical, corporate espionage. And on the other hand, liberals are mostly blind to the problem of the growing secrecy industry. For instance, large corporations cooperate intensively with state intelligence agencies by building trapdoors into mass market computer systems and so on. And let me mention another very concrete example. I'm quoting now Gustavo Diaz Meiti. OSINT, that is to say open source intelligence, is changing the traditional conception of intelligence. By 2015, most small or medium-sized states will be able to acquire intelligence from a diverse range of commercial satellites. This development will progressively lead to the importance of the private sector in intelligence. The technological revolution in general and OSINT in particular are multiplying the competition in intelligence production. There are now more actors in intelligence, which has consequently led to the concept of an intelligence factory, end of quotation. So one of the main challenges to liberal theoreticians of secrecy and intelligence is to avoid one-sided analysis that emphasizes only the protection of the private sphere. I am aware of the fact that all these remarks were somewhat eclectic and improvised, but I hope that I convinced you that secrecy and the intelligence present extremely important challenges to the very core of liberalism. Thank you for your patience.